I'm supposed to give you an explanation for almost everything you heard in the previous two talks. I'm trying to do that. Not going to be easy, but nevertheless, I think I can handle the task. So I'm talking about models of supernovae. And so that's my favorite model of a supernova. Actually, Stan has tested this with me. It's a great model, right? You will see that it's supernova 2010. It's a single malt Eli whiskey. But they don't give it a full Christian name. There are two letters missing. And so I checked the internet, and the most exciting supernova of that year was HH. Here is the Lick Observatory discovery picture. And then our friend from CFA took a spectrum, and it's a superluminous one. So it really doesn't fit that model, because this is a 60 degrees, very tough single malt whiskey with a superluminous supernova, subluminous supernova, so it doesn't fit together. To be more serious, this is now what we've seen in some form before. I call that the beauties and the beasts. The beauties are the supernovae that follow the Phillips relation. You can see that here. And there are many, many outliers, faint ones, bright ones. And the task of modelers is clearly to explain not only the bulk, as you can see here, but also the outliers. So lots of what I'm going to talk about will be about the outliers. And the question I'm going to address is, can we explain the 1As by forward modeling? That is, we take initial conditions in the progenitor model, we take combustion hydrosimulations, radiative transfer, and then compute synthetic light curve spectra and compare with observations. So that's the question, can we do that? And we heard about all these kind of progenitors, the single degenerates, the comets Chandrasekhar mass, usually, pure deflagration, delayed detonations, gravitationally confined detonations, subchandras, and so on. There are lots of them. And the double degenerates could be two white dwarfs, CO, and one CO and a helium white dwarf. Also, that is possible. And the question is, which of them are realized in nature? And I will argue that I believe all of them. Okay? So a little bit of physics, thermonuclear explosions. The basic idea is we have the ash of carbon-oxygen fusion at high densities is nuclear statistic equilibrium, mostly iron group. With decreasing fuel density, we get intermediate mass elements, oxygen from carbon burning, and in the end, nothing is burned. So that is the basics. And the different luminosities, that's the first parameter in the game, the different luminosities are believed to be result of different masses of radioactive nickel 56. And it could be done in different ways. It could be different initial conditions somehow, higher or lower density, or it could be different white dwarf masses. Again, I will argue that all that is a reason. There's a main reason, but there are several reasons. The physics we are discussing is, in contrast to what we learned about core collapses the other day, pretty well under control. Because that's exactly what happens on Earth. We have premixed flames, chemical flames. We are studying them for decades, centuries, and we know what we are doing. We can have deflagration waves, that is subsonic burning in the laboratory. We have spontaneous detonations occasionally. We have deflagration to detonation transitions occasionally from subsonic to supersonic. All that we have in the lab. And again, the question is, which of them are realized in supernovae? And again, I will argue all of them. Nature was mean to fill us in with everything that is possible, which is not so unusual. Nature does what it can do. Sorry. Spontaneous detonations, oh, sorry. So let's briefly go through the different physics here. We have to model turbulent combustion, and we learned to do that over the years. And the codes that do it are in pretty good shape. They are used by car industry for combustion engine pre-design, and they work. And there's a lot of money involved, and therefore, we trust them. Yes? That, I think, it is not very often in astrophysics that you can test your codes directly against terrestrial experiments. This has been done. These are large eddy simulations, and they are in very good shape. Mercedes. Well, actually, I understand. Long ago, I knew that Volkswagen was cheating with NOx for reasons I can tell you in break. Anyway, spontaneous detonations, there the question is, okay, this could work for them, but the question is, how do we ignite a spontaneous detonation? And I'm going to address this a bit. And then the mode of propagation, I'm not going to talk much about that. There are certain uncertainties still involved, but they are pretty well under control as well. I skip over that. These are the uncertainties in modeling spontaneous detonations, but they are handled. The deflagration detonation transition is another issue. This was invented to make Chandrasekhar Mars explosions more bright. Again, I will show in a minute why pure deflagrations can't work. One needs some additional ingredient to make normal type 1As, and therefore people invented this. The problem is that this was never observed in terrestrial combustion experiments without obstacles. If you have obstacles on the way, such a transition can happen. If the fuel is confined, it can happen. But in free combustion, it was never observed. So the question is this a problem of scale space? In a star, we have many more scales than in the lab. It could happen that we need that in order to make that transition. And the other question is, do we really need it? And I will argue, not necessarily. Maybe there, but it's not needed. So just to convince you again that we know what we are doing here in combustion hydro, this was an experiment run by some Russians. They had a tunnel here 30 meters across, along, filled with 7% hydrogen in air. They ignited, and there were lots of obstacles on the way. And they ignited the hydrogen, and somewhere in the middle, it started from a deflagration to a detonation. And this one here, the experiment, the solid line, and the dashed line is a numerical experiment. So it's a computation, and it completely follows it. It did the transition, it made everything right. Actually, these codes were developed to understand why the Chernobyl reactor blew up. And with that, we knew. We now understand what happened there. This was an anniversary, and this year. So this was a deflagration detonation transition that blew up that reactor, although the concentration of hydrogen in air was low. It can happen with obstacles. So in addition, we have to model radiation transport to couple the hydro to the data. And this is done in a post-processing step. We need 3D non-LTE Monte Carlo radiative transfer to compute the light curve spectra. There are two codes out there, one by Dan Kesson, Sedona and ours. And both codes are working fine. They have shortcomings, and just this is a list. We are aware of all those shortcomings. But nevertheless, I don't think that they are so severe that they kind of destroy what we are doing. So now come to the models. So I go through all the ones I've shown you in the zoo. Pure deflagration models is the easiest to start with. I take a Chandrasekhar Mars model, let it, or a near Chandrasekhar Mars model, ignite it somewhere. The main problem there is still the ignition conditions and the initial composition. This we don't know. We have to model it. There are model parameters. There are lots of papers that have modeled those in the recent years. And this is just showing you a bit of that. So we kind of, in our simulation, we usually change the deflagration strength by putting in a certain number of ignition kernels. And if we put in a small number of kernels, we burn little. And if we put more in, more foam of initial flames, then we burn a lot. And that's what the outcome is going to be here. I don't show yet spectra. I come back to that later. Here's the energy. In 10 to the 51 ergs. Here's ejector mass, and that's the total mass ejected. That is the mass in iron group elements, nickel 56, and so on. First thing you can see is the maximum nickel we can get is around 0.3 solar masses. So these models will never give you a bright type 1A. The ejector mass, you can see, is sometimes below the total mass. So there is a compact remnant left behind in all, not a compact, there is a remnant left behind in all those simulations. So in many of those, pure Chandrasekhar mass, you would call them the standard classical single degenerates, the prediction would be that white dwarf is not completely disrupted. There's something left behind. And a prediction of that would be, well, the brightness could be all these very faint O2 CX-likes. The prediction would be to the late luminosity that should be a contribution from the bound remnant. That's a hot, puffed up white dwarf remnant. It should emit radiation, and you should have a source of extra photons, maybe narrow lines or so, in late time spectra. And in some cases, it seems that we have seen it. And these were the OC CX-likes. Delayed detonation, which for a while were the favorite of everybody. So you have a deflagration and a deflagration. I don't show a movie. Now I'm lucky that I didn't show a movie. Maybe my other movie won't work. So the deflagration front goes out. At some time, at some stage, there's a certain condition met for put in by hand, transition to a detonation, which is now here in violet colors. And the detonation goes on, and in the end burns most of the fuel that was left behind by the deflagration wave. So what are the consequences if we now in this pure deflagration put in a detonation? Then suddenly now we get bright ones. Here again you see the fraction of the mass, the total mass of the white dwarf is one, Chandrasekhar mass is here 1.0. And then you see essentially everything is exploding, the ejecta masses, total star is disrupted. The nickel can go up to 0.8 solar masses and can be as low as 0.2. But we don't ever go below 0.2 solar masses. So whenever you have a supernova that had 0.1 solar masses of nickel, and there are plenty of them around, there can't be delayed detonations. The bright ones can, but not the others. The problem is they don't follow the Phillips relation. I come back to that. Okay, you can put in an extra parameter, that is rotation. So we've been using models of Jon and Langer, rapidly rotating white dwarfs, then can bring the white dwarf to two solar masses with enough rotation. And this is a typical example of an ignition here. And then in the end, it becomes non-spherical. It's clear that the burning front essentially can go along the polar axis, but not equatorial, because matter that would burn would move to places with strong angular momentum. So by angular momentum, it's prohibited to go sideways in scope polar. So such a rotating white dwarf would explode in a more polar way. Again, now here are nickel masses, ejecta masses, nickel masses. So essentially, you can go close to the Chandrasekhar mass in nickel, the two points here. So you can make very bright type 1As if they are rapidly rotating Chandrasekhar mass white dwarfs. The problem is they would also have very high velocities because lots of nuclear energy is produced here and it's just kicking out the stuff. So they are not a good model for the very luminous type 1As. Okay, next, Chicago's pets. Gravitationally confined. So we have a couple of lovers here of Chicago confined detonations. Stan is a lover of that. He thinks it's what's happening. So in some cases, what you have in Chicago cases, that you have an off-center ignition point, and this bubble then moves up, driven by buoyancy, breaks through the surface of the white dwarf, the hot ash of the deflagration wraps around, meets at the far end, and triggers a detonation there. That's why it's called gravitationally confined detonation. We also did something recently on this. In our case, we do not meet the conditions for detonation, the standard condition for detonation, although it's not quite clear what the standard condition is. But if we put in by hand here a detonation now, like Chicago, then that's what's happening. We burn the rest of the white dwarf in a detonation. And though what we get is here is a detonation stuff, and around here is the hot deflagration ash. But it's already clear what you see here. This will be very viewing angle dependent. What such a supernova would predict is very viewing angle dependent. And so we've computed the abundances here. And that what this model predicts is here at the far end, where the shock meets, you still have lots of unburned carbon and oxygen at high velocity, which is not observed in most supernovae. Whereas on the other end, where the hot ash is, you have all this burned stuff at high velocity, which is also not observed. So this Chicago delayed detonation model, as the Chicago gravitationally confined detonation model, has severe problems trying to fit any of the supernova. But again, be careful. I'll tell you in a minute. Spontaneous detonations, okay, that's something that can come in various flavors. We can have violent mergers, double detonations, triples, anything you want. And lots of people have recently looked at those. I just show as two examples here. One is the Subchandrasekhar double detonation in its cleanest form. You have a CO white dwarf surrounded by helium layer. Helium layer ignites detonation. Detonation wraps around, sends shock into the CO core, and the CO core ignites carbon burning and detonation and explode. Why this works in this case and not in the Chandrasekhar mass case is because this sub-Chandrasekhar mass white dwarf has a low density, and therefore the detonation not necessarily burns everything into iron group elements. Okay, this is again a snapshot movie wrapping around, moving in, forming a detonation, and the detonation moves out. So that is a nice model. And the second model is here just a double degenerate merger with a helium layer on top of the lower mass white dwarf. So in this case, you have a massive white dwarf and a lower mass white dwarf. The lower mass white dwarf will be distorted by tidal interactions. And if it has a little tiny layer of helium on top, this helium, and now I'm wondering whether this will work. No, it doesn't. Let's see if I can start the movie. No. Okay, sorry that the movie doesn't start. Sorry? No. Somehow. I'm not. Here we go. Okay, it's a pointer. Let's see whether it works. Here we don't go. The codecs are not on. No, it doesn't matter. Anyway, so because this shows snapshot shots again that I can use to explain what happens. So that is just snapshots of that movie. So here I have the density, the temperature, and the composition. That is a lower mass white dwarf, the higher mass white dwarf. That's the helium that goes over by tidal interaction overflow to the more massive one and ignites a detonation here that then wraps around. So this would be a double detonation in a double degenerate. You can have all the double degenerate. Okay, but this, I believe, is the most promising model we have around. Anyway, so this works. Now, confronting with observations. So I promise to do that. So in the past, we always did it on a case-by-case basis. We tried to fit a spectrum to a supernova and vice versa. Now, I advocate to do something different using a statistical approach. Since we have so many supernovae observed, and we start to compute more and more models, we have to find out whether they, in a more statistical way, in a generic way, agree or disagree, and thereby single out what the right models are. And so we used PCA for that. We constructed a metric space from multi-epoch optical spectra from day minus 17, from day minus 12 to day plus 17. We took public data, because they are more diverse than we had in Supernova Factory when we developed this method. Actually, since we want to compare models, we want to get rid of uncertainties due to reddening and distance. Therefore, we took the logarithm of the spectral flux and the derivative. Okay? to eliminate that, we compute then principal components of synthetic spectra of the models and can do a direct comparison. And then we can also correlate with photometric properties using PLS. So that is a metric space, the PCA space, PC1, PC2, that's the main component, second component, third component. And then you see already that these here, the normal ones are the green ones, somewhere up here. Peculiar ones are down here. The blue ones are peculiar ones. The 91 VG likes are here. High velocity silicon ones are here. So they really separate nicely in this PCA space. So all your friends you will find somehow represented in that space. This is again now PC1, PC3 cut through that space. Again, 90T, 91T likes down here, high velocity silicon here, normal ones now a band about here, and so on, and peculiars down here. Then O2 CX likes. So that is, now I throw in my models, okay? I just show you how this works. So the spectrum, we can reproduce the spectrum and get calculated back. That's the kind of quality we reach. That's for a calculated spectrum, Kenno-Modus W7, also doing a reasonably good job. And now that is the PCA space, PC1, PC2 first. And these are the delayed detonation models, and they are all here. So they are where observed type 1As are, but not certainly not the normal ones. They reach into the 91T like here. And only if you do some tricks to the delayed detonation models, unmix them in a way, you change the chemical composition by hand, then suddenly you also start to fill more of the space of the normal ones. So something is screwed up in these delayed detonations, which we don't quite understand what it is, but anyway, they don't fit so well. But nevertheless, you will always find an observed supernova that fits a particular model you've calculated delayed detonation. Same is true if you go to the pure deflagrations. The pure deflagrations are down here where all the peculiars are. We expected this to be the case from the beginning. They are here. If you take then the subchandras, they scatter all over this place, which is good. Actually, these are pure pure white dwarf cores without helium. If you put in some helium, you might fill in the rest. These are the mergers. We don't have many models for mergers yet, but they are more faint for the time being. The Chicago model, just for curiosity, different viewing angles fill in here. That's again the Chicago model for the other components. You can play the same game for the other components as well. And so the conclusion here would be all models have an observed counterpart as far as spectroscopic properties are concerned. Okay? I give you a model, and this method finds me that supernova that fits this model best. And there is always one. It's not a disjunct space, it's the same space. The normal one is that the problem are somewhat underpopulated, and the question is why. And now correlations, I go quickly through that because it's interesting. So the damn thing is that most models do not correlate with the data in that respect. So on the individual basis, fine, but not for correlations. So we know spectroscopic properties that correlate with color, with luminosity and all that, silicon 2, velocity equivalent with all this, so we can build that into this game. And then you suddenly can predict the B minus Z color in the data, this clear correlation. But again, the models do not fit that at all. So something wrong with the colors of all our models. All our models, on average, are too red. We compared with the bulk of the normal type 1A. You find peculiars that fit, but the bulk seems to be off. The same is true that's an amazing, we just got the other day, the Chicago delayed detonation is the only one that gives such a correlation for different viewing angles. Weird. Well, you can go to B magnitude again. So always the subchandra somehow fit best, much better than all the other models. Here's Chicago delayed detonation again. That is for B minus V color. You can do it for delta M15. So the conclusions here is none of the model classes reproduces observed spectra correlation between spectra and photometry. Well, this could be an incomplete scan of the parameter space. We have to do many more models, I think. And maybe the explosion modeling or the radiative transfer is not good enough. I don't know. So let me just quickly go through the summary and outlook. So I think the physics and numerics of forward modeling is in reasonably good shape. But what are the correct initial conditions? Can we constrain them by observations? I think that is, we all agree, that's where we stand now. So most of the realizations we have in from the zoo, all plausible models have their counterpart in the observed data space. So the problem is correlations, which I think are the really now constraining the models, because certain model classes will never be able to fulfill certain constraints for the bulk. So we can rule them out as sources of the normal. We can't rule them out as being maybe a site of an extreme outlier, but of the normals. So the point we would have to calculate, of course, hundreds and hundreds of models. They are expensive. And we may find other ways to combine forward and backward modeling. We are working on that right now. Automated fitting and so on could be a way. So that is kind of my concluding slide. The best of the bulk normal type 1A for me, the best bet would be double detonations. And the first parameter there would be the white dwarf mass that determines the luminosity and the Phillips relation. We've shown that. And the second parameter that gives them the diversity would be the amount of helium that is detonating on top of this LCO white dwarf. That would be my best bet. Actually, one has other constraints which I don't have time to discuss. And this is polarization. We have now been able to compute polarization spectra for the model. And on basis, knowing that the normal type 1 n's never have high polarization, neither continuum nor lines, we can again rule out most of those models on that basis for the normal 1As, with the exception of the subchandras again, and to a certain extent the delayed detonations. So again, there are constraints of that kind that bring us to the conclusion for the bulk, we may have a single class of models, but not for all of them. Okay, these are a list of people who worked with me on that over the years. And with that, I close. Thank you.
Thank you for the great overview. I was wondering if you'd comment on like two separate issues about the detonation in double degenerate. So first is about, so in the double degenerate which shows the detonation, it was generally done as like a space simulation in the beginning, and then when we see a temperature about 2-3 gigakelvin, then it is mapped to Eulerian grid and the temperature is increased of one cell to a point when the detonation happens. So this was like the first point. If you could comment on like how, what is the like a sort of correct justification for doing that? And the second issue is about the double detonation. So in the one-dimensional models, it is a spherical detonation which is converging towards the center, which is by definition will converge because of the geometry. In the two-dimensional also, it is a torus basically which will converge, and that is also a geometrical effect. How do you think will in three-dimensional this result will hold up? Thank you.
The collimation will work in 3D as well as in 3D, it doesn't matter. Because it will always have converging shocks. And wherever the shock converges, you trigger detonation. That's unavoidable. It's so generic. Of course, you can kind of, you see, with this double detonation, I only fill a very small part of the parameter space yet of the observation. If you want to fill in more to get the bulk, most of the bulk, you have to have other parameters. And one of the other parameters could be that maybe this was rotating and the helium detonation did something weird, and so it was kind of triggering an offset of detonation, a largely offset of detonation in the CO white dwarf, and so on. So this would give you an extra parameter, then we would get line of viewing angle effects and so on. If we have this huge PCA space of data, and so far we populated only sparsely. Mm-hmm. And so the models have to have enough parameters to do that. And that is my main conclusion. A single degenerate Chandra-Lippermann model doesn't have enough degrees of freedom to give you a spread of effect of 10 or more needle mass, to
give you all this diversity in spectroscopic data, how the hell can you get that from a single chapter? We need to have more. Mm-hmm. As long as we believe they're all the same, it was fine. But now that we know they are quite different, nature plays a dirty game. It is. Mm-hmm. So the same is true for the contamination. Also, we tried this one example from the Chicago computation on time and then the other realizations of that. We ignite at a different distance from the center, the parameters are all the same. I would think one would have to find ways to produce hundreds of models, thousands of models, and then play that statistical game also for the models and not just taking the metric space compartment from the spectrum and throw in a few models, they all get there for the time. So far, I can only say, well, give me a model and I tell you what the supernova looks like.
I think we'll just leave it right there. That's great.